Tonight's program is dedicated to the memory of Reverend Martin Luther King Jr., who was not only an ardent supporter of Israel, but he was one of the most eloquent speakers during the Civil Rights Movement. Good evening. I'm Laurie Cardoza Moore, your host here at Proclaiming Justice to the Nations, or PJTN Online. The mission of Proclaiming Justice to the Nations is to educate our Christians, Jews, and people of conscience all over the world about their responsibility biblically to stand with our Jewish brethren and the State of Israel against the rise of anti-Semitism. We accomplish that goal by producing award-winning documentary films and television programs and distribute them to our 2.6 billion viewers around the globe in 200 nations through our 21 global media partners. And so we're delighted that you've joined us again this evening. For those of you who are new to the program, we want to welcome you here. We hope that you'll find tonight's program inspiring and encouraging. This is your opportunity here at PJTN Online to ask questions and to get engaged in the conversation. We hear from Christians all over the world who watch our award-winning program, Focus on Israel, on Daystar, God TV, and our other 21 global media partners, and I receive emails every week. So I try to open this up here on Facebook, Facebook Live, so that we can have this conversation, so I can help share information with you, and you can help learn to articulate it and share it with your family and friends. Since our mission is to educate Christians about their biblical responsibility, we want to provide this engagement platform so that you can be engaged in this process as well. Of course, you can always email me at comments@pjtn.org with your questions. So we would also want to encourage you to become a PJTN watchman today, to take watch on the wall in your community to stand against the rise of anti-Semitism. If you see or hear about an anti-Semitic incident in your community, we want to hear from you. In Joel chapter 3, verse 9, the Lord said to the prophet, "Proclaim this to the nations, prepare for war." That word prepare in the Hebrew actually means to sanctify a war, and that is what we are fighting today. It is a battle for truth. With the recent events unfolding in Washington, D.C., it is clear that the battle for justice and righteousness is increasing against our Judeo-Christian values, especially as it pertains to Israel and the United States and our unique relationship. In Leviticus 19:16, the Lord also said, he told Moses, "We are reminded, you shall not stand by while your brother's blood is shed." So if we call ourselves followers of Christ and we worship the Judeo-Christian God, the God of Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, or Yahweh, then we too are called to stand with our brothers. We cannot stand idly by while they are being persecuted. We will be held accountable. At a time when there is greater opportunity for Christians to study God's word, we are witnessing a growing number of Christians who have adopted replacement theology, stating that God is done with the Jews and Israel and they are no longer our brethren. Now they believe that the church has replaced Israel, presenting no biblical evidence or foundation to make such a heretical claim. Are Gentiles not grafted into the Commonwealth of Israel, as Paul said? Because we're reminded in Ephesians chapter 2, verses 11 through 13, when Paul said, "Therefore, remember that you, once Gentiles in the flesh, who are called uncircumcision," or Gentiles, "by what is called the circumcision," the Jews, "made in the flesh by hands, that at that time you were without Christ, being aliens from the Commonwealth of Israel," or from the nation of Israel, "and strangers from the covenants of promise." What covenant of promise? The same covenant of promise that God made to Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and their descendants forever. We are grafted in, but he goes on to say, "having no hope and without God, but now in Christ Jesus, you who were afar off have been brought near by the blood of Christ." If you are a follower of Yeshua or Jesus Christ, then you have been grafted into the Commonwealth of Israel. Paul talked about that in the book of Romans as well. This is part of the nation that we have grafted into. We have decided to worship Israel's God. We can look at many stories in the Bible where there were Gentiles who actually followed Israel's God. We look at Israel's God. We look at Rahab when she protected the spies during the time of Joshua, when Joshua took on Jericho, when he fought Jericho. There's the story of Ruth. She was a Moabitess, but she decided to worship Israel's God. She became a convert, and we too have converted into the nation of Israel. When God asked Cain where his brother was, he responded with the question, "Am I my brother's keeper?" Well, unfortunately, we see anti-Semitism and anti-Zionism growing globally because most Christians are not aware of this teaching. Most Christians are not hearing this type of teaching from the pulpits because of the replacement theology or the supersessionists believing that the church has replaced Israel and the Jewish people. The false accusation that Israel is an apartheid state, that Israel is occupying Palestinian land, this is all propaganda that further fuels the anti-Semitic BDS movement against Israel. If you are not familiar with the term BDS and would like more information about this anti-Semitic movement and what you can do to get involved, I encourage you to go to our website, our store page, order a copy of our award-winning film, Boycott This. This documentary was produced for the millennials, for a younger audience, to show the millennials that the same narrative that they hear on here on college campuses is not true. We interviewed Arabs who are Muslim, Christian, Bedouin, Druze, and their story is different than the one that we hear coming out of the Palestinian Authority or the radicals on our college campuses who are falsely accusing Israel of being occupiers and killing Palestinians, imprisoning them, and killing children. These statements are not true. It is propaganda, and we have to be informed. So you can order that documentary on the website. As I mentioned earlier, anti-Semitism is growing among Christians. Historically, it is replacement theology that has fueled anti-Semitism in Christianity using New Testament scriptures, quoting New Testament scriptures out of context to justify this unbiblical and heretical teaching. We can look recently in October when the Tree of Life Synagogue was shot up by Bowers. This man was a supposed Christian, a nationalist. He practiced nationalist Christianity. And so if Hitler would have been around, if he was around during the time of Hitler, he would have been a follower of the Nazis. As I mentioned earlier, anti-Semitism is born out of ignorance, and that's why our programs are so critically important, to give a biblical foundation of truth so that people understand, so that Christians understand and see the Bible and the history of Israel and the plan that God has for Israel and the Gentiles who decide to follow and worship Israel's God. So it's important that we are informed and educated from a biblical perspective. The purpose of our award-winning programs and documentary films is to confront that ignorance with biblical truth. If you would like more information about the history of Christian anti-Semitism, I would encourage you also on the store page at our website, pjtn.org, order a copy of The Forgotten People, Christianity and the Holocaust. This documentary is a wake-up call to the church in our generation to condemn this growing threat in our communities. God told the prophet Obadiah that in the latter days he was going to wipe out the descendants of Edom because they stood by while their brother Jacob was held in captivity and they did nothing. How will God judge the church? How has God judged the church in years past? Because they stood by during the pogroms, during the Inquisition, during the Holocaust, and many times those Christians were involved in persecuting the Jews. So it's important that we know that we are going to be judged. God will judge the church because historically we did stand by. The Lord said that he would bring the nations of the world into judgment in the valley of Jehoshaphat on account of his people, Israel. This is the judgment of the last days. And I think we can all agree that we're living in the last days, but this is the judgment. How we treated Israel, how we treated our Jewish brethren. We are all going to stand before Almighty God one day at that great white throne of judgment. And he's got the book of life and the book of death that is opened up. And which book will we find ourselves in? Because we will be held accountable for what we did and didn't do. We won't be held responsible for what the church has done in previous generations. We're going to be held responsible for what we did in our generation. If we call ourselves a follower of the Lord and we refuse to stand with our Jewish brethren and confront this age-old hatred once and for all. Unfortunately, that anti-Semitism has now infiltrated our children's textbooks and our instructional materials. Last night, I had the honor of appearing on Mike Huckabee's Huck's Heroes, and we talked about this. We talked about how our children are being indoctrinated with propaganda in our textbooks and our instructional materials. Our children are also being fed a version of revisionist history about the United States. And of course, we're lacking in our Holocaust education. The standards across the country, in states across the country, are changing, and the Holocaust is being minimized at a time when we have very few Holocaust survivors who are alive to tell as witness, to bear witness to the story of what they had to live through. Now it's going to be the second generation. It's going to be the children who survived, the survivors that will have the story. But every generation that we get further and further away from the Holocaust, the story is going to change. It's going to be minimized, and they will be telling a different story. You know, General Eisenhower, in our documentary, The Forgotten People, made an incredible statement when they liberated the concentration camps, and he told the people that were there with the film cameras and photography cameras, he told them, "I want you to film everything, document everything, because someday someone is going to come along and say this didn't really happen." And ladies and gentlemen, for those of you who have been following this issue with regards to the Holocaust and the anti-Semitism that is on the rise, you know full well that we're hearing the rumblings that the Holocaust didn't really happen, or there weren't really 6 million Jews who died. It was a lot less. That's what we're hearing today. Eisenhower made a prophetic statement back then in 1945, and we should heed that, and we should be aware that this is growing, and that's why we have to speak out. As our children are being given indoctrinated with revisionist history and an inaccurate perspective of the Holocaust, the role of both Jews and Christians have to play a significant role in protecting our constitutional republic and protecting the information that we are giving to our children or is being taught to our children in our local school districts. Additionally, we are teaching unconstitutional content to our children in U.S. schools that favor the religion of Islam over all others by teaching them the tenets of the Islamic faith. This is happening all the time. I hear from parents who contact me and they're fighting their local school districts. There's a couple of school districts across the country where lawsuits have been filed because of this very thing. Through the now decades-old influence of Pearson-published textbooks and biased instructional materials published by the Muslim Brotherhood's front group, CARE, they are feeding our children a daily dose of a distorted view of history, of our country, and of our Judeo-Christian values. PJTN is on the front lines in this war, and we can't do it without you. We are exposing the agenda, and we are educating parents and grandparents and citizens, taxpaying citizens, because you pay taxes for these textbooks and these instructional materials. You have a voice. You have a responsibility to protect this constitutional republic as well. If you are not familiar with this growing threat in America's schools or our PJTN nationwide campaign, I want to encourage you, when you go to our website to purchase those documentaries on our store page, that you also go to the Our Issues page and read more information about the K-12 initiative that we are pursuing in many states across the country. These are just some examples of the important work that we're doing to educate Christians, Jews, and people of conscience all over the world. Earlier this week, we sent out a press release. And for those of you who are on our mailing list, if you're not on the mailing list, I want to encourage you to go to our website, pjtn.org, sign up to get on that mailing list so you'll stay informed of events that are going on and how you can get engaged in the battle with our calls to action. But I sent out a press release calling on U.S. House Speaker Nancy Pelosi, demanding that she rescind the appointment of Representative Ilhan Omar to the House Foreign Relations Committee. To have extended this appointment to an important committee to an avowed anti-Semite was an arrogant slap in the face to Americans who refuse to tolerate people who are anti-Semites. And for those of you who are not familiar with her, Omar was condemned for a tweet that she put out in 2012 that said, quote, "Israel has hypnotized the world. May Allah awaken the people and help them see evil doings of Israel." Although Omar's constituents may endorse her anti-Semitic views, the majority of Americans do not. And of course, polls show that Americans support Israel over the Palestinians by 70%. That's important to note, ladies and gentlemen, because if you listen to these people talk, you would think that the majority of Americans agree with them. They do not. The majority of Americans understand terrorism. The majority of Americans remember 9/11. We know what Israel faces on a daily basis with a barrage of missiles that are constantly raining down. Just recently, within the last 24 hours, Syria. There was an attack in Syria by the Israelis because Syria is mobilizing. Actually, Iran is mobilizing in Syria and in Lebanon through Hezbollah and through ISIS. Of course, Hamas. We know that there was an incident today where the Israeli government released funds coming in from Qatar, but they withheld them for about 48 hours because the Israelis were concerned that that money from Qatar was going to fund terrorists. Well, we all know that it is. And unfortunately, the world does nothing to stop it. This Representative Omar, she is not qualified for any appointment, let alone a committee that oversees all foreign assistance, national security affecting our country, foreign policy, treaties, peacekeeping, and war powers. Where are the qualifications from this woman who was born in Somalia? She is of Ethiopian descent. Where are her qualifications that she would sit on one of the most important House committees in our Congress? This is outrageous. Nancy Pelosi knew exactly what she was doing. And this was a slap in the face to Americans, to President Trump, and to all people of conscience, especially in our government. It was outrageous that this woman was chosen. She does not have the credentials to sit on such a committee. Is it possible that Omar is ignorant or ill-informed? Or is she spreading disinformation and promoting a false narrative that Jews are controlling the world as they have, in her words, hypnotized the world, which actually sounds like something that comes out of the Protocols of the Elders of Zion, another false document. And of course, We hear nothing from Nancy Pelosi. We did put out a statement, and we were calling on our watchmen to contact her office, and unfortunately, they are being blocked from contacting the Speaker's office. When they go to call her to leave a message, they go follow the prompts, and when they get to the prompt to leave a message, there's the inbox is full. They can't leave a message, can't send an email either, because if you're not a constituent of hers, we should be able to communicate with the Speaker of the House and with the Senate, because these people have control over a whole body of government, or a whole House. And this is critically important. This issue is critically important. We have never put an anti-Semite in such an important position. We've never put an anti-Semite in the Congress. I mean, we have two of them, Rashida Tlaib, and now we have Omar. Adolf Hitler wrote in Mein Kampf, if you tell a big enough lie and tell it frequently enough, it will be believed. One of the greatest theologians in the last century, Dietrich Bonhoeffer, many of you know him, lived a radically different life than most Christians of his time. Unlike most Christians, he spoke out against genocidal anti-Semitic ideology and National Socialism. His opposition ultimately led to his execution in 1945 by the Nazi regime just 4 days before the concentration camps were liberated. Christians should look to Bonhoeffer as a role model in this hour and rise up in opposition to the Democrat Party and its anti-Semitic social agenda. Once again, this age-old hatred has infiltrated the highest offices of a democratic government and thus demands a firm stand from Christians, Jews, and all people of conscience. As we begin a new year, Christians around the world must be engaged in this end-time battle. We're going to show you another way that you can financially support this end-time mission with PJTN. We're going to watch a quick video, and when we come back, I'm going to tell you about our global initiatives and how you can get involved. Take a look.
This month marks the 70th anniversary of the historic Declaration of the State of Israel. God's sovereign hand can be seen all over this land. Included in the celebrations is the opening of the American Embassy right here in Jerusalem. In honor of this celebration, PJTN is offering a special 70th anniversary package, which includes a captivating new book and an award-winning DVD. Israel Rising is a unique visual story of Israel's miraculous journey from unforgiving desert to thriving nation. Thousands of years ago, the prophet Ezekiel foretold a future time in which the arid land of Israel would come alive for its people. Now this breathtaking book documents the fulfillment of this vision as rarely seen photographs from the 1880s to the 1940s are juxtaposed with recent photos of the same locations. This book will inspire and captivate you as it illuminates Israel's foretold awakening in a new and unforgettable way. In addition, you'll receive the award-winning documentary, Israel Indivisible, The Case for the Ancient Homeland. This inspiring film examines the many political twists and turns that make Israel the world's most controversial nation. From Abraham and the Promise to the issues facing the Jewish state today, the film examines the historical, archaeological, legal, and biblical foundations for the modern state of Israel. This is a limited time offer for these two remarkable resources for just a one-time gift of $70 today. Your generous donation will help ensure that PJTN stays on the front lines and in the headlines of all the important issues facing Israel and our Jewish brethren. So please go to pjtn.org today.
Welcome back. As I mentioned earlier, tonight's program is dedicated to the legacy of Reverend Martin Luther King, Jr. Not only was Dr. King an ardent defender of the Jews who spoke frequently about the connection between the plight of the African-American community, slavery, and Israel, but he constantly affirmed God's covenant to all Israel through the biblical stories he shared. We're going to watch a portion of PJTN's original program, Focus on Israel show, about the Jewish community and its relationship to the African-American community during the civil rights movement. Take a look.
You look at a nation like Israel, they're like a postage stamp. And there's a demagogue in our midst on the international stage, Ahmadinejad, president of Iran, who has basically said he wants to see them wiped off the face of the map, the face of the earth, gone. Now, should we be concerned when a demagogue wants to enrich uranium and gain nuclear capabilities? Should we be concerned? Absolutely. When someone says something like that, and they have the weaponry and seeking the weaponry to carry it out, they need to be taken seriously. I mean, in the middle of the last century, we had a demagogue who pretty much wanted to do the same thing. His name was Hitler. And he went about doing it. And millions of people lost their lives. We are not going to be on the wrong side of that issue again, particularly as a man of color who knows the history of Jews being involved in advancing the causes of people of color, particularly with the founding of the NAACP. Now, here's a little known fact. Many people don't even realize that W.E.B. Du Bois did not start the NAACP by himself. There were prominent Jewish Americans alongside him seeing this movement through. The Spingarn family, Joel Spingarn, professor at Columbia University, Arthur Spingarn, activist of the day, and another Jewish man, Henry Moskowitz. Now, he was a civil rights activist for Jewish causes at the turn of the last century. These men were deeply involved in spearheading the birthing of the NAACP, the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People, and Jewish people were alongside people of color to see that through. And they birthed it around the anniversary, the 100th anniversary of Abraham Lincoln's birth. Very interesting correlation there too. But nonetheless, bear in mind, with that kind of history, we need to be closer than we are today. We need to be closer. And we can't forget that the NAACP served a righteous cause, served a righteous cause. Its embryonic stages were during a time of wanting to see injustices eliminated. So we can't forget men and women who are of African descent, particularly in this hemisphere, in this country, can't forget the help that came from the Jewish American community to see our causes advanced, to see them through. And that happened all the way up to the Civil Rights era. You had the prominent Jewish people involved in that as well. Dr. King was fully aware of the sacrifice that Jewish people were making for the Civil Rights Movement in the 60s. You had one rabbi, prominent theologian. His name was Abraham Joshua Heschel. I mean, you don't get any more Abraham Joshua. Jewish rabbi, theologian, walking with Dr. King in Selma. And Dr. King fully understood the importance of standing with Jewish people. And he was an ardent Zionist. We don't get too much into that regarding Dr. King's life, but he was. I mean, I have a quote here. I want to share this with the people. This quote, when I read this, this is from 1965, Dr. Martin Luther King. "How could there be anti-Semitism among Negroes when our Jewish friends have demonstrated their commitment to the principle of tolerance and brotherhood, not only in the form of sizable contributions, but in many other tangible ways, and often at great personal sacrifice? Can we ever express our appreciation to the rabbis who chose to give moral witness with us in St. Augustine during our recent protest against segregation in that unhappy city? Need I remind anyone of the awful beating suffered by Rabbi Arthur Levelveld of Cleveland when he joined the civil rights workers in Hattiesburg, Mississippi? And who can ever forget the sacrifices of two Jewish lives, Andrew Goodman and Michael Schwerner, in the swamps of Mississippi?" Now, these are men who gave their lives for the cause. It stands to reason that they should be deeply connected. When you have blood shed on both sides for the same cause, there's a bonding that occurs. And that bonding created the golden age, or was a part of, I should say, the golden age of the Jewish American, African American connection. Finishing the quote, "It would be impossible to record the contribution that the Jewish people have made toward the Negro struggle for freedom. It has been so great." Now here's the pinnacle representative of the civil rights movement, understanding the importance. Now we've taken our cues as men of color and people of color in this nation from Dr. Martin Luther King, and here he is giving a pretty sizable cue. We need to be closer knit with the Jewish American community. Not only that, to the cause of Jewry worldwide, if it means their survivability, and it does right now, especially with the existential threats that exist today against the nation state of Israel.
The word support means remember. We remember that you stood with us during our time of struggle.
The history of Israel and Black America has an amazing parallel. When you look at these two people groups, you have one who were slaves to ancient Egypt, and you have another who were slaves to modern America. The Jews, Israel, still celebrate every year the fact that they were enslaved and then they were set free. It's called Passover. When you consider Black America, we too were enslaved. And when you consider the exodus of Black America, they used to sing these, what we call old Negro spirituals, and they likened themselves to the exodus of Israel. In other words, they would talk about Moses, lead your people out. They would talk about the promised land that they were heading to. They talked about crossing over Jordan. They paralleled their problems with the problem of Israel. And when you consider in the mid-1900s, when Jews and blacks found themselves really in a fellowship of suffering, where there were signs that would say no niggers or no Jews, and some even said, and no dogs. It was Jews and blacks who founded the NAACP together. It was Jews and blacks who founded the National Urban League. It was Jews who stood with us and my forefathers here in this country who marched with us, and they were jailed with us, and some were killed with us. During the 1950s and 60s, during the height of the civil rights struggle, there was a tug for the leadership of Black America. On the one side was Elijah Muhammad, Malcolm X, the Nation of Islam.
Concerning nonviolence, it is criminal to teach a man not to defend himself when he is the constant victim of brutal attacks.
And then on the other side were Baptist pastors, Martin Luther King Jr., Ralph Abernathy.
Now let me proclaim here and now that I am still convinced that the philosophy and practice of nonviolence affords the more excellent way to improve the inadequacies existing in the American social system.
And so here you had Christians and Muslims, both trying to vie for the heart of Black America. The one group were cursing Israel. They were anti-Semitic. That was the Nation of Islam. The other group, led by Dr. King, blessed Israel. They talked positively about the Jews. In fact, Dr. King marched with Jewish rabbis. And so you have the cursing of Jews and you have the blessing of Jews. And God was very clear, if you bless the Jewish people, I will bless you. God went on to say, if you curse the Jewish people, I will curse you. Black America, to our benefit, followed Dr. King's cry and call. And so as a result of him blessing Israel, God blessed us as a people.
I just want to do God's will. And he's allowed me to go up to the mountain. And I've looked over. And I've seen the promised land. I may not get there with you, but I want you to know tonight that we as a people will get to the promised land.
Islamo militants are resorting to using animals to do their bombings. The optimist in me says that maybe they're recognizing the value of human life. And instead of strapping bombs to themselves or children, they got dynamite donkeys to detonate. Hey, before the donkeys explode, do they go, Allahu Akbar? Believe it or not, I'm not trying to be facetious at Israel's expense. The joke in itself is how Israel has to struggle for support against enemies of such obvious evil. Somehow, Israel, the small nation that it is now Goliath. And Islamic territories that surround Israel is somehow David. I'm Alfonso Rachel with Zonation, and my band has a song about messing with Israel called Special Delivery. Moses had it playing in his iPod when he went to go talk with Pharaoh. Check out the link. It's Good Fight for What's Right music.
First and foremost, there's never been a state called Palestine. We're talking about nomadic Arabs.
And what really concerns me is the agreement now, this reconciliation pact between Fatah and Hamas. And then go back to history and understand where the word Palestine came from. You know, in 73 AD, when Emperor Hadrian sent out his decree after the Romans conquered Judea, they just changed the name. Palestine is a region. And once upon a time, everyone who occupied that region had on their passport Palestine. There's always been a state of Israel. After 1948, we have a modern day state of Israel. So we need to respect that. And the people who call themselves Palestinians need to have a right and a respect of that state of Israel. Until then, until there's a willing peace partner, there really can't be peace.
The eugenics movement in the United States caught wind by the Nazis. The Nazis in Germany, they were sharing information with each other about how to control people groups, how to control those quote-unquote human weeds in your society. For the Germans, it was Jews. So the eugenics movement in the United States and the Nazi movement in Germany, both trying to squell and curtail two people groups. Here we are now on familiar ground. Both blacks and Jews hated. Hated by the same groups of people. We are one in those causes, and we need not forget that. We need not forget it. And that spirit still exists today. There are people on this planet who want to see Israel gone. And as a man of God, I won't stand for it. And as a man of color, knowing that that Jewish people have been involved in advancing the cause of people of color, so I'm going to stand with Israel. And I think we in the African community, both African American or Africans anywhere, particularly people of God, we need to remember the connections, the shared struggle, and stand with them. In a time when their existence is being threatened, we need to stand.
You know, I think that we're beginning to see something beginning to emerge even in the Afro-American community in terms of its understanding of what God's doing with Israel. And I contextualize this in terms of something that we'll all understand historically, Dr. Martin Luther King and the Civil Rights March. Many people agree that it probably wouldn't have gotten off the ground in terms of becoming a national movement if it hadn't been that the Jewish community, many who were lawyers and many who were those who helped fund some of the marches and the things that needed to take place, represent them in terms of civil rights matters, that it actually was the Jewish community that looked and said, we understand that the plight of the Afro-American community, insofar as injustices and racism, we have felt that. We know what that's like. And actually, we see parallels that are just like the children of Israel coming out of Exodus, there in the book of Exodus, coming out of Egypt to be delivered, that we understand that this is a moment in history that we, who often felt abandoned, Holocaust and everything, that we get to come alongside the Afro-American community, which incidentally was actually a church movement before it was a civil rights movement. It was actually the church that was trying to address issues of injustice. I see something coming back around now, even as the Jewish community came to the assistance, and if you even see some of the black and white film and pictures, you'll actually see actual rabbis. I'm thinking of one of the famous rabbis, Rabbi Abraham Heschel, walking arm in arm with Dr. King. Well, they were close friends. And they both shared, obviously, the same Bible and the same perspective as to the importance of this. Now, what I see now is something prophetically happened almost in the reverse. I'm seeing Afro-American leaders now arising who are not merely being identified merely in their local community, but in a more regional way. I have the privilege once a month of being on a conference call that goes from Atlanta, LA, Chicago, Louisiana, Mississippi, and these are regional Afro-American leaders who understand that God is extending the boundaries of His kingdom in extraordinary ways. Well, our last conversation, and we were on for 2 hours in prayer and conversation about the place and the role of Afro-American leaders toward Israel and standing with Israel. So it's almost like the reverse order. The Jewish community and the civil rights movement came down to the South and to march with Dr. King and the civil rights movement and all of that. And now it's almost like God says, okay, now it's your turn. And we're watching Afro-American community leaders. And you know, the thing is that they actually have a natural DNA to be reconcilers. I believe it's in their very DNA and blood. And it's interesting, even if we realize that, I'm thinking in the book of Acts, that the Ethiopian, who was the treasurer, you know, the queen of Candace, you know, he had already made his connection with Israel. But as he's coming through the desert, God would stop a revival to have Philip join one chariot in the middle of the desert. And this man happens to be reading at that moment Isaiah 53, you know, and Philip preaches Christ to him. And this man, of course, goes on his way back. And we know even extra biblically, the Bible tells us that more of the kingdom of God and the gospel spread through that encounter than all other regions and places. So I'm saying that there are places that we see how God has used, you know, again, in many ways, the Afro-American community, which has seen atrocities, injustice, racism, but of all the communities, perhaps, in our nation, in our land, that they would be used of the Lord in this hour. So one of the things that I really believe that as God is raising up a people of color in this hour to be involved because they're part of the church, you know, and that we're called to stand with Israel. And one of the things I'm excited about in this hour is that we're seeing Afro-American leaders and people of color who are beginning to discover their role in participation and seeing healing of the body of Christ and Israel and coming together to see reconciliation. And I believe that no one is in many ways better suited to do this than Afro-American leaders, especially in their struggles and the civil rights movement, and now coming to a point where God would give them a place and a role to see Israel and the church come together in these last days for God's purposes. So I think we're going to see more and more leaders rise up to in the Afro-American community to discover their role and participation in seeing Israel and the church come together as never before. This is an exciting
From
time.
From studying history, it's very clear that what starts with the Jews never ends only with the Jews. We must strongly stand against any anti-Semitic trends, for if not stopped, they'll cause harm to all of us, and we'll witness the downfall of our Judeo-Christian Western culture. Today, many people say there's no longer a need for a Jewish state, that Jews around the world no longer need a place of refuge. But anyone who has heard recent statistics about the worldwide rise in anti-Semitism would never make such a claim. The reality is that neo-Nazi groups and Nazi sympathizers are increasing around the world. Surveys show that over 1 billion people in the world harbor anti-Semitic attitudes. Close to 50% believe that Jews have too much power in the business world, and two-thirds of the world's population has never heard of the Holocaust or believe the historic accounts of it are inaccurate. If there's one thing history has taught the Jewish people, a place they can go in time of need is essential, and Israel fulfills that role. But the need for a Jewish state is not limited to being only a refuge for Jews. Jewish tradition in Israel grants full rights for women and people of all races, faiths, and gender. This tradition is what often makes Israel among the first countries to send doctors and field hospitals to any place where a natural disaster occurs, utilizing their medical advances to save lives worldwide. Muslims, Christians, and people of every faith, or those of no faith, have the freedom to worship or not worship as they choose. For Muslims, the Jewish state goes out of its way to provide this freedom. For example,
every Israeli university gives students the option of deferring their exams during the month of Ramadan. The Knesset calls off all sessions at sunset during Ramadan to ensure that Muslim Knesset members can break their fast with the traditional iftar dinner. In an open and democratic manner, opportunities for education, advancement, and careers exist for all citizens in the Jewish state. Sadly, such rights and opportunities do not exist in any of the Muslim Arab states. For example, in neighboring Jordan, Jews cannot become citizens. And in Saudi Arabia, no non-Muslim can become a citizen. Saying that Israel must cease to exist as a Jewish state while accepting that other countries define themselves as Muslim is pure hypocrisy. In most of these countries, no rights exist for non-Muslims, women, and the LGBT community. Don't let yourself be manipulated by evil people with a wicked agenda. When the self-serving villains are in control, good people from all religions suffer. Muslims, Christians, and all people of conscience should stand proudly and show respect for a country that gives so much to the world in so many ways. Do your part, do your research, and do what you can to make a difference. Because what happens in Israel does affect us all. This is not just a Jewish or just an Israeli problem. This is a problem for all humanity, for each and every one of us who believe in freedom and human rights. Learn more about what you can do at pjtn.org.
Although Dr. King and his legacy have been used to falsely accuse Israel of oppressing the Palestinians, his support of Israel against the terrorists are well documented. For example, in an article that was published on H.com by Yvette Altmiller, she has captured a couple of quotes from Martin Luther King Jr. This one quote about Jews and African Americans, she says, when King was invited to address the American Jewish Committee Convention in 1958, he noted the great similarities between Jews and African Americans, who both experienced hatred and prejudice and who worked to overcome that hatred, when he said, quote, "My people were brought to America in chains. Your people were driven here to escape the chains fashioned for them in Europe. Our unity is born of our common struggle for centuries, not only to rid ourselves of bondage, but to make oppression of any people by others an impossibility." She went on to say, with regards to anti-Semitism and racism, there is a quote from him where it says, "There are Hitlers loose in America today, both in high and low places. As the tensions and bewilderment of economic problems become more severe, history's scapegoats, the Jews, will be joined by new scapegoats, the Negroes. The Hitlers will seek to divert people's minds and turn their frustration and anger to the helpless, to the outnumbered. Then, whether the Negro and the Jew shall live in peace will depend upon how firmly they resist, how effectively they reach the minds of the decent Americans to halt this deadly diversion. Probably more than any other ethnic group, the Jewish community has been sympathetic and has stood as an ally to the Negro in his struggle for justice." He goes on to say in another quote about Zionism and anti-Semitism. She writes here, October 27th, 1967, just a few months after the Six-Day War, King had dinner with students from Harvard University in Boston. Professor Seymour Martin Lipset was present and recalls how one of the students criticized Zionists. King was incensed, saying, "Don't talk like that." And continuing, "When people criticize Zionists, they mean Jews. You're talking anti-Semitism." The following year, just days before his tragic murder, King addressed an annual Jewish assembly and explained his pro-Israel feelings at greater length. He explained that Israel and Arab states are different conceptions of what constitutes peace. Arab states are consumed with inequality and require fundamental changes in their societies before they can feel secure. Israel, in contrast, desires only secure borders and for the world to recognize its right to exist. Peace for Israel means security, and we must stand with all of our might to protect its right to exist. Now, these are the words of Martin Luther King Jr. Its territorial integrity and the right to use whatever sea lanes it needs. I see Israel, and never mind saying it, as one of the great outposts of democracy in the world and a marvelous example of what can be done, how desert land can be transformed into an oasis of brotherhood and democracy. Peace for Israel means security, and that security must be a reality. So, ladies and gentlemen, again, as I said, as people try to falsely accuse or misrepresent Martin Luther King Jr.'s position on Israel and anti-Semitism, it is very clear in what has been documented and preserved through these centuries or through these decades. That's our program for tonight, and I hope you found this informative and interesting, especially in light of this week being the week that we remember such a great leader, such a great Christian leader, who we should emulate and live and follow his example. We will continue our conversation next Wednesday night, so I hope that you'll tune in and join us, and don't forget to share this program with your Facebook family and friends. As always, if you have questions, comments, you can post them right now on Facebook. You can also email me at comments@pjtn.org. And this is your opportunity again each week to have a conversation with us at PJTN. And I hope you found the program interesting. If you want to learn more, you can also tune into our award-winning programs Focus on Israel on Daystar and God TV each week. Daystar, our program broadcasts at on Saturday nights at 6:30 p.m. Eastern Time, 3:30 p.m. Pacific Time. And then, of course, you can also catch it on Daystar Sunday nights at midnight Eastern Time and 9 p.m. Pacific. And on God TV, if you've got God TV on your network, you can also tune in at 2:30 Eastern Time to watch Focus on Israel each week on Daystar and God TV. If you haven't gone to our events page on our website, I want to encourage you to see where we're going to be next. I'm traveling. I've got a busy schedule. I'll be back in Florida for the next week and a half. If for those of you who are watching from Florida, I hope you'll come and join us. And, of course, if you would like for me to come and speak to your community, your synagogue, your church, your college campus, I'd love to come and share our programs with you. Please keep Israel and the Jewish people in your prayers. There's a lot going on in the Middle East right now, and they are being hard pressed on every side. Pray for the peace of Jerusalem, that you may prosper who love thee. I also just want to remind you, if you have prayer requests, please send those requests to comments@pjtn.org. We want to pray for you. And remember to like us on Facebook, follow us on Instagram and Twitter, and subscribe to our PJTN TV on YouTube to watch more of our original PJTN programs. I want to thank you again for joining us this evening. God bless you, and thank you for all you do on behalf of our Jewish brethren and the State of Israel. We'll see you next week right here on PJTN Online. Good night.
To support this program, send your tax-deductible gift to Proclaiming Justice to the Nations, P.O. Box 682711, Franklin, Tennessee, 37068. You can also support PJTN online. Visit pjtn.org or call 1-877-873-9020.
Anti-Semitism has reached epic proportions, and Israel is now surrounded by nations who seek its destruction. For Israel to lose just one battle would mean losing everything. As Christians, it is our biblical responsibility to stand with our Jewish brethren and Israel. PJTN needs your help to reach more Christians with this urgent message. please visit our website to become a member today and order our award-winning documentaries. You must decide that you won't be silent. Sign up now at pjtn.org. God bless you, and thank you for your support and prayers.